We're going to pray for a minute. I want you to pray for me more specifically as we share God's word. Oh Lord, I thank you for everybody who made it out this morning, Lord, to spend time with you, to put you first place in their life, God. And Lord, we only want to hear from you. I've got some stuff in my head, but I want the Holy Ghost to speak, Lord. And so I pray that you would hide me in the shadow of your cross, and that the overwhelming message be that God sent his Son, a holy God sent his Son to die on the cross for our sins, and he arose again from the dead and is seated at the right hand of God the Father forever and ever. And because we have Jesus Christ in our lives, we will spend eternity with him. Amen. Amen. That's good news. That's the good news gospel. If anyone watched Billy Graham's funeral at all, you'll have had a chance to hear some of his children talk about him. And the one story from his daughter was really significant for me, because when you're a preacher's kid, it's very difficult, because everybody expects you to be perfect, because you're the preacher's kid. And so here's one of his daughters talking about some of the not-so-good moments in her life. And so she was sharing about how she had been married for 21 years, and both her and her husband made a lot of mistakes, and their marriage came to an end, and they were divorced. And of course, that's painful. Divorce is always painful, especially though you're concerned that you're bringing shame upon your family in that case. And so then she moves to be closer to her family, to her other sister, and starts going to church, and she meets a widower. And she starts very fast and furious into this relationship with this widower. And everybody's like, maybe you should slow down, take your time a little bit. You know, you just got out of a divorce. But she was like, oh no, you can't tell me what to do, you know, blah, blah, blah. And so what happens? She gets married to this guy. And she said, within 24 hours, I had made the worst mistake in my life. And 5 weeks later, I left him, called my parents, told them I was coming home. She drove for 2 days, came into the driveway of the Graham residence, and her dad was standing there waiting for her. And she got out of the car, and all she got was a hug. She didn't get a reprimand. He didn't say, how disappointed I am in you. He didn't say, why didn't you listen to our advice? All he did was say, welcome home. And that's what Jesus does to us. Every time we mess up, every time we screw up, because we know better, because Jesus told us better, and we still screwed up, he's still there waiting for us, wants to give us a hug. But like any parent, he doesn't want us to go through those painful experiences. So I'm going to read from Jeremiah 38. Jeremiah 38. And before I go there, James, do you happen to have that first video ready?
Yeah.
Ed, I may need the center lights turned out just for a second. James is going to play this video for us.
This episode of Big Cat Rescue is brought to you by Audible. Go to audiblepodcast.com/BigCatTV to get a free audiobook download of your choice when you sign up today.
Okay. Never turn your back on big cats.
Thank you.
cute, right?
Yeah.
No. Those cats would have eaten him if there wasn't a fence there. And why did I show you that? Because that's what Satan wants to do. And he wants to eat you. He wants to kill you. He wants to destroy you when you're not paying attention. When you're focused on God, you can see things a lot better. When you go to an encounter weekend, all of a sudden you get this revelation. Wow, God, you're amazing. Oh man, I got this junk in my life. I need to get it out. But what happens is, the next week comes by, and you go back to your daily routines and stuff like that, and we're not as close to God as we used to be. And Satan is waiting for you to turn your back just for a little while. Because he knows if you'll turn your back and get your gaze off of Jesus just for a little while, that's when he wants to pounce. And I wanted to show that video because we're going to read from Jeremiah 38, verse 1. And I'm going to read fairly quickly, and then I'll take a few pauses. It's Old Testament stuff, so get ready. Zephaniah, son of Matan, Gedaliah, son of Pashur, Jeculiah, so I'm going to keep going, heard what Jeremiah was telling all the people when he said, "This is what the Lord says, whoever stays in this city will die by the sword, famine, or plague, but whoever goes over to the Babylonians will live. They will escape with their lives, they will live." So what's happened here is the people of Israel have rebelled against God. And they said, "God, we're just going to do stuff our own way." What happens when you do stuff your own way? You get your own results. So what happens now is they've been rejecting God long enough that now there's a Babylonian army which is up against the city waiting to attack them. And so Jeremiah, because he's listening for God, he wants to save the people. And so he starts to tell them what God is saying. Because God speaks. In whatever situation we're in, God is actually speaking. The question is, are we listening? So here's what Jeremiah says. And this is what the Lord says. "The city will certainly be given into the hands of the army of the king of Babylon, who will capture it. Then the official said to the king, 'This man should be put to death. He's discouraging the soldiers who are left in the city, as well as all the people, by the things he is saying to him. This man is not seeking the good of these people, but their ruin. He is in your hands,' King Zedekiah answered. 'The king can do nothing to oppose you.' So they took Jeremiah and they put him into a cistern of the king's son, which was in the courtyard of the guard. They lowered Jeremiah by ropes into the cistern. It had no water in it, only mud, and Jeremiah sank down in the mud." So this is not a good spot to be in. What happens when he's in the mud? He's going to die. There's mud. He's sinking into the mud. Ever feel you're sinking into the mud? God gives you a word. But then what happens? Trouble happens. It's not always easy to say what God is saying. Because the whole world is out against you. Because Satan doesn't want you to hear what God is saying. So he tries to shut you up one way or the other. So in this case, he puts him in a well and says, "Shut up." Because Jeremiah is saying, if you'll surrender, it's going to be okay. Just surrender. And that's the same story Jesus is telling us. He's telling us, just surrender to me, and life will get better. So let's keep reading. But what happened is a Cushite heard about what had happened. See, when we're in trouble, God uses people and he uses his word to speak to us. And so he might be thinking right now, "Oh great, the king turned his back on me and these guys put me in this well." But I want you to know that in no matter what situation you're in, no matter how desperate you are, God can use people to get you out of a situation. People who are listening to him. Let's keep going. Malak went out to the palace and said to him, "My lord, the king, these men have acted wickedly in all they have done to Jeremiah the prophet. They have thrown him into a cistern. Well, he will starve to death when there is no longer any bread in the city." Then the king commanded Melech the Cushite, "Take 30 men from here with you and lift Jeremiah the prophet out of the cistern before he dies." So Melech took the men with him and went to a room under the treasury in the palace. He got some old rags, worn out clothes, and some rope and went to Jeremiah in the cistern. The Cushite said to Jeremiah, "Put these old rags and worn out clothes under your arms to pad the ropes." So Jeremiah did so. And they pulled him up with the ropes and lifted him out of the cistern. And Jeremiah remained in the courtyard of the guard. Then King Zedekiah sent for Jeremiah the prophet, had him brought to the third entrance of the temple of the Lord. "I'm going to ask you something," the king said to Jeremiah. "Do not hide anything from me." So now the king is saying to Jeremiah, "Listen, I want you, okay, if you've got your cell phone and you're not texting somebody to come to church, I'd really appreciate it if you turned it off right now." Cool? Thanks. Even, so here he is in front of the king, but he's scared of the king. Because the king can choose whether he lives or dies. And he knows he doesn't have a good word for the king. You ever had that? You have to share something with a friend of yours, and it's not necessarily the best thing. You know they might not like it. You know they might not like you if you tell them the truth. And so you go to a person in love. So Jeremiah is about to go to this king, and he knows he doesn't have a good word for the king. So here's what he says to the king. He says, "If I answer you or tell you the truth, aren't you going to kill me? Even if I did give you good counsel, you would not listen to me." But the king Zedekiah swore this oath secretly to Jeremiah, "As surely as the Lord lives, who has given us breath, I will neither kill you nor hand you over to those who want to kill you." Then Jeremiah said to Zedekiah, "This is what the Lord God Almighty, the God of Israel, says. If you surrender," everybody say surrender, "to the officers of the king of Babylon, your life will be spared and the city will not be burned down, and you and your family will live." You and your family will live. Romans 6:23 says, "For the wages of sin is death. But the gift of the Lord is life." Sin, death. God, life. So what is he saying to the king right now? He's giving the king the option. He's saying, "King, here's what God is saying. You've got a choice to make. He will spare your family and you will live. But if you will not surrender to the officers of the king of Babylon, this city will be given into the hands of the Babylonians and they will burn it down. You yourself will not escape from them." King Zedekiah said to Jeremiah, "I am afraid of the Jews who have gone over to the Babylonians, for the Babylonians may hand me over to them and they will mistreat me." Okay, you ever have God tell you something and the first thing you do is start making up excuses why you shouldn't do what he just told you? "Well, God, if I this or that," you know, and you start negotiating with God. Like if he says, "Hey, don't have sex before marriage." "Yeah, I know, God, but, you know, he or she is really pretty." And listen, God's a holy God. He loves you. And if he tells you something, it's to help you, not to harm you. But what happens is he tells us something, and the first thing we start to do is argue with him. Maybe it's tithing. Maybe it's, you know, "Hey, why don't you spend a couple minutes in the morning with me before you go onto your phone or something?" "Yeah, but God, there might be some messages waiting for me." Mm-hmm. Okay. So this is what's happening with this king. He hears the word of God to say surrender so you can live, but the king, he starts using his carnal knowledge. Carnal knowledge is limited. But God's word is unlimited. Because he's the Alpha and the Omega. He knows what's going to happen tomorrow. You don't. He does. I'll show you what I mean. Your life will be spared. But if you refuse to surrender, this is what the Lord has revealed to me. All the women left in the palace of the king of Judah will be brought out to the officials of the king of Babylon. These women will say to you, they misled you and overcame you. Those trusted friends of yours, your feet are stuck in the mud. Your friends have deserted you. All your wives and children will be brought out to the Babylonians. You yourself will not escape from their hands, but will be captured by the king of Babylon, and the city will be burned down. Then Zedekiah said to Jeremiah, do not let anyone know about this conversation, or you may die. If the officials hear that I talked with you and they come to you and say, tell us what you said to the king and what the king said to you, do not hide it from us or we will kill you. Then tell them, I was pleading with the king not to send me back to Jonathan's house to die there. All the officials did come to Jeremiah and questioned him, and he told them everything the king had ordered him to say. So they said no more to him, for no one had heard his conversation with the king. And Jeremiah remained in the courtyard of the guard until the day Jerusalem was captured. Then Jeremiah said to Zedekiah, this is what the... Everybody stand up for a minute. I'm awake. Repeat after me. I'm awake.
I'm alert.
I want to receive what the Lord has for me.
Because
He loves me.
Amen.
James, what verse are we on? 28? So here's what happens. In the ninth year of Zedekiah, king of Judah, in the 10th month, Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, marched against Jerusalem with his whole army and laid siege to it. And on the ninth day of the 4th month of Zedekiah's 11th year, the city wall was broken through. Then all the officials of the king of Babylon came and took seats in the middle gate. The chief officer, Nergal Shazer, a high official and over all the officials of the king of Babylon. When Zedekiah, king of Judah, and all the other soldiers saw them, they fled. They left the city at night by the way of the king's garden through the gate between the two walls and headed toward Araba. But the Babylonian army pursued them, overtook Zedekiah in the plains of Jericho. They captured him, took him to Nebuchadnezzar, king of Babylon, in the land of Hamath, where he pronounced sentence on him. There, at Riblah, the king of Babylon slaughtered the sons of Zedekiah before his eyes, and also killed all the nobles of Judah. And then he put out Zedekiah's eyes and bound him with bronze shackles to take him to Babylon. Wow. Old Testament stuff. Gouged his eyes out. What happened? Remember the cat video that we saw? He wanted to do things his own way. He didn't listen to the word of the Lord. And so this awful tragedy happened. Do you know what happened to Jeremiah? The king of Babylon, Nebuchadnezzar, said, oh, by the way, tell Jeremiah he can stay in the courts and do whatever he wants. If he wants to go back to Jerusalem, he can. There's favor. God loves us all the same. But there's favor that happens when we're obedient to him and listen to him. Does that make sense? Pastor Josh has talked about this a lot. It says God's love. You don't have to do anything to earn God's love. But there's a way of operating in this world that we need to pay attention to if we want to live under the blessing of God, because he wrote it in his word. The same way he told King Zedekiah, just surrender, man. You're not going to win this thing. Surrender and you're going to live. What happened? He was afraid, oh, these people are going to say this, and this is going to happen. You don't know what's going to happen tomorrow. The greatest thing you could ever do is to put your trust in God. Do what He says. But Mark, it's hard to do what God says. Yes, it is. I can talk about sin, and you can feel ugly for your sin, and it's not going to do you anything good unless I talk about Jesus. And when I talk about Jesus, I talk about what He's done for your sin and that He's taken your sin away. But unless you receive Jesus and receive His forgiveness, the sin isn't taken away. And that's what you get judged for. And so what's happening in our life right now, and this is, I feel, kind of the message that God wanted me to share with you. God is talking to you about stuff that's happening in your life. He sent someone to your life, somebody like Jeremiah. I think it's more like His Holy Spirit is talking to you about stuff. And I'm preaching to myself here. I think this is why the Lord wanted me to speak this. But there are some things in our life where we're hearing God, but we're going, oh God, that's really not what I want to do. And you know what we're doing then? We're living in rebellion to God. It's not being disobedient. You're living in rebellion. Because God, what did God have for King Zedekiah? He had something good for him. And for the whole city. But they chose to go a different way. And so that's not God punishing them. That's Satan taking advantage of our disobedience. You see, God doesn't bring that on us. Satan brings it on us when we step back out of that covering that God has for us. Now we're out on our own. And we're getting our own consequences. Does that make sense? New Testament. Let's go there. John 5. Ahead of schedule. Good. The healing pool. James is going to take us to John 5. I'm going to start reading. James can catch up. Sometime later, Jesus went up to Jerusalem for the Feast of the Jews. Now there is in Jerusalem near the Sheep Gate a pool, which in Aramaic is called Bethesda, and which is surrounded by five covered colonnades. Here a great number of sick and disabled people used to lie, the blind, the lame, the paralyzed. One who was there had been an invalid for 38 years. When Jesus saw him lying there and learned that he had been in this condition for a long time, he asked him, "Do you want to get well?" Kind of a strange question. Guy's an invalid. He's there. He's waiting for the angels to stir the water so he can get in and get healed. "Sir," the invalid replied, "I have no one to help me get into the pool when the water is stirred. While I'm trying to get in, someone else gets in ahead of me." Then Jesus said to him, "Get up, pick up your mat, and walk." Interesting. Did this guy argue with Jesus? No. Did he say, "Yeah, that's easy for you to say, Jesus, but I'm an invalid"? No. At once the man was cured. He picked up his mat and walked. Now here's where it gets interesting. The day on which this took place was the Sabbath. And so the Sabbath means the day of rest. Don't do anything. And the Jews were very religious. So they were watching Jesus and they're saying, "Jesus, you better not do anything on the Sabbath." Which is perverted because all Jesus was doing was healing people. And so the Jews said to the man who had been healed, "It is the Sabbath. The law forbids you to carry your mat." How ridiculous. The guy just got healed. Who cares if he's carrying his mat or not? But he replied, "The man who made me well said to me, 'Pick up your mat and walk.' So I did. So they asked him, who is this man who told you to pick up and walk? Pick up your mat and walk. The man who was healed had no idea who it was because Jesus had slipped away into the crowd that was there. Later, Jesus found him at the temple and said to him, see, you are well again. Stop sinning or something worse may happen to you. The man went away and told the Jews that it was Jesus who made him well. What was this guy doing? James Barry, scholar of the Bible. What was he doing?
Lacking.
Who knows? Any other Bible scholars? Don Bon John?
He was lacking.
See what I did there? Who knows? Nobody?
Sitting.
Ha! He was sinning, that's right. What was he sinning, though? I don't know. The Bible does not tell us. But Jesus said what? Stop sinning. Easy for Jesus to say? What did he say to the woman who was caught in adultery?
Sin no more.
She said, what's going on, Jesus? And Jesus said, well, where are your accusers? And she said, they're gone. Well, Jesus says, I don't condemn you either then. But what does he say next? Go and sin no more. Easy for Jesus to say. He's part God. So are you. Jesus lives inside you. You have the ability to resist sin. The issue is, we haven't received the revelation of what Jesus did on the cross. Because if we truly appreciated a holy God, then we would go and sin no more. But Jesus knew that there's a good chance that we're probably going to sin. And so that's why we remember the cross and what he did for us. And we say, God, I screwed up again this week. Forgive me of my sins. And you know what he says? Yes, I forgive you of your sins. Every single time. Every single time. Doesn't matter how many times you've been divorced or whatever it is, how many times you've cheated somebody or lied or whatever it is. But what happens is, as we spend more time with Jesus, that lifestyle that we used to live starts to become more distant. But what happens is, if we take our eyes off of Jesus, that lifestyle will creep back inside of us. Because Satan remembers what we did. You see, Jesus forgives us totally of our sins. The Bible says he doesn't even remember it. But Satan remembers it because he's a legalist and he'll use your sin against you. And he'll come back with that very thing that Jesus gave you freedom from, and you'll get entangled in it again. So what's the answer to sin? James Barry, what's the answer to sin? Jesus is the answer to sin. And he so longs to have relationship with us. But we think we're incapable of having a relationship. And that's a lie from the enemy. And sometimes we just take that relationship for granted. And we need to be reminded that God is a holy God. He's a holy God. James, can we show this next video? I'll just set this up for a minute before we play it. There's a movie called Trading Places with Eddie Murphy.
I love it.
And I watched this before I got saved, because there are some scenes in it that are a bit racy. But what happens is Eddie Murphy is essentially a con artist and a bum who's living on the street and pretending he's a war vet with no legs. And these guys catch him and he's going to jail and stuff, but these two rich guys, they want to do an experiment with him. And they're going to say, hey, I wonder if we give him all the good stuff that we have, if he'll actually change his ways and become intelligent and, you know, be like us, or if he'll go right back to the way he was. Okay? So, let's go. Let's roll the clip for a minute.
What do you think?
I like it, man. It's very nice. I like the way you hair and stuff looked up over there. It's very pretty. I like it. I like it, man.
I don't think he understands.
A little louder.
Oh, Marty, I do understand.
William.
Yes.
This is your home.
Uh-huh.
Right. It belongs to you.
Yeah, all of it's mine. I like my home. It's very nice. That's very nice to taste house.
Everything you see in this room is yours now.
Uh-huh. It's my stuff.
Your own personal property?
My own personal shit.
You understand?
It's mine, yeah. I like that.
Yeah, you know what I like most about my place, Randy? The curtains, man. Look at the curtains. It's beautiful the way I got this thing set up.
Yeah, I suppose you're going to just give me this TV set for free, aren't you?
That's right.
Uh-huh. Everything in here is mine, huh? Oh, I guess the stereo is mine free too, huh?
I'm sure.
This is too much for me, man. You know, I can really dig it, man. You know why? This kind of thing happens to me every week.
This is your house. These are your personal possessions. You will only be stealing from yourself.
Look, first you throw my ass in jail, right?
Then you're gonna drive me out of here and start running some garbage for me about this is my house, this is my personal rug, and then you're gonna tell me this is my personal slave, too.
I understand how you feel, William, but the fact remains, all this is yours. You may do with it whatever you wish.
This is my stuff in my place, huh? I can do what I want with this stuff, right? This is my basement, right? This is Billy Ray's base, right? I own this base, and I can do like Harlem Globetrotter shit with it, right? Okay, you want Mel and Lemon shit, right?
Oops.
Hey, man, I'm sorry about that.
Perfectly all right, William. It was your face.
That's a cheap base, man. That was a fake, right?
I think we paid $35,000 for it. But I seem to remember we estimated its value at $50,000 for the insurance company. You see, Mortimer, William has already made us a profit of $15,000.
You want to break something else?
No.
That reminds me of Jesus. It's too good to be true. And even when we break stuff, he says, it's your stuff. He's like, I love you. I want to give you all this stuff. You don't have to steal. You don't have to go anywhere else. Everything that you need is found in me. But he's talking to us. Because he loves us. He wants us to have a better life. He wants us to reject sin and say yes to us, to him. To his love, to his forgiveness on the cross. So let's pray. I'm going to end it. And Lord, I just want to take some time here. Because you love King Zedekiah so much. You sent him Jeremiah to try to help him. And Lord, sometimes you're talking to us and we're just not listening. Or we're arguing with you because we think we know a better way to do it and we just don't. You know the beginning from the end. You know tomorrow. We don't. We cook up these ideas and think we know, but we don't. And what we really have to do is trust you. That what you're saying about us is true. That you love us, you forgive us, you care for us, and that you're holy. And so, Lord, as we're sitting here, I'm just going to take 60 seconds of silence because we can't do it in our own strength. It has to be you. It has to be your Holy Ghost revealing to us truth, your Holy Ghost revealing to us your holiness and how much you love us. You love us. You only want what's best for us. And Lord, I'm speaking out of myself, Lord, that you only want what's best for me. But sometimes I get distracted and I don't really do what you're telling me to do, even though you're telling me over and over again. I say, yeah, tomorrow, God. And it could be anything in your life. It could be how you spend your money, God is talking to you. It could be a relationship that you're having. It could be sex, it could be pornography, it could be gluttony, it could be laziness, it could be anything. Unforgiveness, whatever it is. God wants something better for you. He just wants you to surrender. He wants you to surrender and let him in. Let him into those broken places in your heart. Those places where you feel defeated and you say, God, I just can't do it. And he says, you're right, you can't, but I can. So Lord, we're just going to take a little quiet time. Maybe Carly can come up here and just play the guitar just for a minute or two. And I want to tell you that he loves you so much. But he doesn't leave us as orphans. He talks to us through his word, through people, and through his Holy Spirit. So Lord, we're going to sit here for 60 seconds. And we're going to keep our eyes closed because we don't want to get distracted by anything. And Lord, we just ask that you talk to us. I just want to say, Lord, show us the answer to this thing that we're struggling with. Lord, show us how to surrender. So Lord, this week help us to remember what you're saying and to be empowered to surrender, Lord, to surrender. It is too good to be true, just like that video clip, it's too good to be true. We didn't do anything to deserve it, Lord. Oh, but you love us. Oh, God loves you. God loves you, he loves you, he loves you. He loves you, he loves you, he loves you. He loves you, he loves you. Hallelujah. 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 Andrew, why don't you come up front for a bit? If anybody wants prayer, I would love to be able to pray for you this morning. If God's talking to you about something, you can say, hey, I could use some prayer about something. We'd love to talk to you. We'd love to pray with you. Jesus loves you. Have an awesome Sunday. You can stand up. And James will put on some background music. Don't forget about our Kingdom Encounter, our March 24th to 25th with Patricia Dutzma.